There are many of our people who are thinking more deeply and more broadly, are looking at it as it actually is, and are beginning to see it more in the international context and the relation that it has with the African struggle, a human rights struggle, or the struggle for human rights. And as such, we can then take it into the United Nations.
We bring about the freedom of these people by any means necessary.
Peace, family. Welcome to We Charge Colonialism. We Charge Colonialism, an organization that seeks to completely liberate our people from the horrible, horrible, and very much impactful institutions of colonialism that oppress our people on a daily basis. I want to say before I even start this video that if you have applied to become a member of We Charge Colonialism and have not heard back, please understand that we weren't unaware that our form on our website has been broken. I don't know why. So we're trying to fix that problem. But in the meantime, if you have submitted an application and have not heard back from us, could you please, please, please email us or even leave a comment, some type of indication, and we will try to get that information to you. So long as you give us your contact, we can actually find a way to communicate until this problem is fixed. So what we're going to talk about today is something that I'm sure you guys have seen many times and have experienced possibly, particularly if you're online, you might have experienced some hatred coming at you or some hatred coming from people like you towards other Africans. We're going to talk about this thing called the diaspora wars. This idea that us who are separated really by experiences and histories that are different but similar in a lot of ways, we become the enemies of each other more than we become the enemies of our oppressors. This is a serious problem, one that is not unique to us, one that is not new. We should obviously understand historically that there's always, always, always been an intentional effort to separate people who are oppressed from their brothers and sisters. When you look at the colonization of Africans, there was always an intentional effort to have a certain class of Africans who were going to be given preferential treatment by the oppressor so that the others who see them as not being of them and instead look at them as being their oppressor instead of the white man who put them in that place to begin with. Similarly, inside of the enslavement of Africans and the Americas, you might have noticed, obviously, that there's always been an intentional effort to have some Africans who are going to be given some benefits on the plantation, some Africans that are going to be made to think that their interests lie in the interest of their master, because the ultimate goal is to ensure that those Africans will rat on the other ones. Those Africans will sabotage any movement from the other ones. Those Africans will be more than willing to sabotage the total African liberation because they identify themselves with their oppressor. Understand, again, these are all things that are not new. These are things that have always been done. So I'm going to read from a statement put on the WCC website, and it was one of our newest press releases from our brother Jamal. He says, "We have seen white instigators tell African Americans that Africans do not like them." This is something I heard growing up. Then they will, in the same breath, tell stories of Africans being told by whites that African Americans are dangerous. Then the FBI deliberately find content to paint Africans in a bad light that is divisive. That is a divisive tactic. And when some continental Africans trust Europeans more than any other nationality, is it a divisive tactic? We constantly bring up COINTELPRO, but then want to call people an agent with no proof. Understand that we have been put inside of this cycle where we are just repeating history over and over again without any willingness to confront the person who put us in this position to begin with. And that is really the problem with the diaspora wars. I challenge you, if you have more of a problem with who's starring as Fred Hampton, or who is starring as Harriet Tubman, or who might be starring as some other role, depicting someone who is from the enslavement experience in America, then understand that if you're going to have that smoke for that and not have smoke against the system that even made you a slave to begin with, that even killed Fred Hampton to begin with, if you're going to have more smoke for that because you can find it easier to target people who look like you than actually target the system of white supremacy, then you have fallen into that category. You have fallen into that category of people who fell for the bait. You believed your master. You believed that you're actually better, or your experience is something that should be separated from the global African experience. You took the bait, and it's no way getting around that. It's so easy to fall into these ideals, to fall into the self-aggrandizing that white supremacy has put us in, to think that one colonization experience is better than the other, to think that one colonization experience should be preferred to the other. Also understand that this idea that has continued to be circulated, although I see it less and I hear it less, so I'm taking that as a good indication, that Africans are better fighting for ourselves separately than together. It's just not intelligent. What person, what people are better fighting for themselves separately than together? Could you imagine during World War II, and I use that as an example because it's a common example that I'm sure many of you have heard of or studied inside of your education experience. Could you imagine when France was getting pounded by the Nazis and you had all these other European powers who basically fell by the wayside, but then Britain was one of the ones who was not completely overtaken and the United States was coming over too. Could you imagine had France told them, hey, Britain, United States, I need you to leave me alone. I'm going to fight this on my own. I'm going to deal with these Nazis by myself and I'll get over to you whenever I have time. That doesn't make sense. Why would you want to deal with your oppressor when you're all facing the same oppressor? Why would you want to separate yourself when you're already losing? Again, already losing. All of us are already losing when you look at the condition of African people internationally. These are things that are put into the psychology of our people, in the psyche of us, rather, to make us think that we're putting ourselves in a position to deal with white supremacy when we're actually falling into the plan of white supremacy. Intelligence should tell you that anything that would have you connect yourself with people who are similarly situated is something that is going to go against the interest of those who maintain power over you. It's just common sense. So at this point, I urge you to stop falling into these notions. Now, let me talk to other people, though, because obviously I'm more so directed towards Africans from the United States, but also my brothers and sisters overseas, please. Do not respond thinking that it's okay to use things that have been said against us by our oppressors to you and think that that's something that is okay to be responsive of. Of course, we understand that there's been a lot of division that has been created among our people, but these ideas that, hey, Africans in America, you have no culture, or you're not really African, you don't really have any standing in our history. Anyone who would share those type of sentiment, you also are a betrayer of African liberation. You should know that because every single person who has stood for African liberation in the past, and I mean actually stood, not people who tweet, not people who make op-eds, not people who do YouTube videos, people who actually fought inside of the fields for your people, all of them would tell you to the contrary. Any unapologetic African who has ever stood up for the people has always recognized our common experience among ourselves, not as a separate commodity, but as a collective people with a shared experience that has to confront the oppressor collectively. So I say this to all my brothers and sisters that I'm probably going to have to stop talking about this issue because it's just kind of like you're going to keep talking about it because it's always going to be ignorance. But at the same time, I do want to emphasize that we need to be clear in our language to call out these types of things as being counter-revolutionary, counter-liberation, counter-African. You're not doing anything to give credence to your people, to the struggle, to the people who have bled and died. I mean, think about how many people in our history have had such a Pan-Africanist impact. Think about the fact that Marcus Garvey, who never set foot in Africa, fought for African liberation from the Americas and from Europe. Think about the fact that people like Malcolm X, who came from America and he went over to Africa and he had the support of people like Nkrumah and different African leaders. Think about people like that who were spit in the face of. Think about the Nkrumahs who said that, hey, it's not that you're born in Africa, it's that Africa's born in you. Think about the legacy of our people as a collective, as an international people who have always, always been connected through our shared history. And last but not least, think about who you're benefiting. Because if you're not benefiting your people and you're playing into the hands of white supremacy, understand that what you're doing is not going to do anything to your good. Forget the fact that it's also not to our good, but to your good. You're actually fighting against your own interests, regardless of whether or not you realize it. So that's what I have on this subject. what are your thoughts on the Diaspora Awards? Please be, I'd say, what's the word? Please be positive, you know, please use productive conversation, no furtherance of separation, because obviously, again, we don't want to fall into the hands of the enemy and further our separateness. And instead, we want to make sure that we're using a unifying call to fight this system that's hurting our people collectively. So that's all I have, and I will see you all in the next video.